Okay, very good morning to everybody. Today, my team is going to present to everyone the emotional design model. So, before we start, okay, we are going to use the car example to illustrate to everybody. Basically, for my part, I will give everybody a very brief concept of what is EDM, in short, which is emotional design model. And then my partner, Horng, will be telling you guys more in details later. Okay, just to make sure everybody is on par, can I have everybody raise up your hand with me? Everyone. Okay, thank you. Please keep your hands up first. Okay, please, before you put down, okay, can I have a show of hand? Who would like to own this car on the left? Keep your hands up. Okay, very good. Who would like to own this car on the right? Okay, thank you. Basically, nobody would like to own this car on the right. Okay, this is the first part of our EDM, which is why. Can I have this? Matt, can you tell me why would you like to own this car? Because it's
Will be working and functional.
Because it looks functional and looks it's working. Matt, why not this car?
Because you can't do anything with the hand.
Because it looks dangerous, right? So the first level of it is we choose, okay, based on what the looks of it. Alright? Now next, let's move on to the second part. Anyone prefer to drive a car with auto car? Anyone prefer to drive an auto car? Don't worry, I won't ask you a question if you raise up your hand. Okay. Thank you. Why? Easier to drive. Okay, anyone prefer to drive a manual car? Ah, very good. Okay, handsome boy at the back, why? Why? Why a manual car and not an auto car?
Fun.
Sorry?
Fun.
Okay, for you it's fun and for you it's the other one is because it's easier to drive, right? Okay, when we buy a car, there are a lot of different functions. Can anybody identify for me what are the rest of the choices? Okay, let me give you one example. Okay, the meter. For a car, there are different meters, right? We have the analog, which is the needle that's pointing up and down when we drive to show us the accelerations, the speed we are. Or there are digital ones, right? Anybody have any other ideas on what other choices there are? Ah, yes, thank you. Okay, so there are the types of window button as well, the manual one and the auto one, right? Which is the one that we press up and down, or the old style that is wind down. So, therefore we choose based on what we have learned, right? What we, like she said, it's easier to drive as well. Okay, the next level, okay, can someone complete this sentence for me? People buy this car because? The young man there, blue young man. Can you complete? Yes, it's you. Can you complete this sentence for me? People buy this car because? Because of the design. Okay, what about you, sir?
Because they want to show off.
Because they want to show off. What about you? People buy this car because?
It's style.
Okay, if you realize that it's more on a design, more of the culture, the status. Am I right to say that? Because it looks cool, because it's very stylish, because you know, it's like it's high standard of living and it looks expensive. So designer knows that people want to feel this way. Thus the values, now we no longer choose based on maybe the first look of it. We no longer choose based on what we have learned. Now it's more on the values and belief when I buy this thing. Correct? When I buy this car, it's more on, oh, it's more high status, or it looks cool, or it's more stylish. Alright? Then next, Horng will take over and explain to you guys more about it.
Right, morning everyone. Just now, what we talked about, usability, the look and feel, and the preferences of car, are actually very closely related to emotional design model. But before I go in depth about it, let me share with you the ATM experiment. Well, there were two Japanese scientists who were interested to find out. The two scientists are Masaaki Kurose and Kaori Shikamura. They were very interested to find out how attractiveness can affect usability, which is why they make use of two ATMs. They share the exact same functionality, except with the fact that there's one that's arranged attractively. Well, interestingly, most of the people who use the attractive one find it easier to use. This kind of puzzle, the Israeli scientist, Norman Tresnigi, he was incredibly puzzled. Well, it's logical that people are attracted to appealing stuff. But why would the attractive stuff be more usable? And he thinks that the answer is deviated by the fact that Japanese have different cultural factors. And besides, Israelis are pragmatic people. They don't care about design, they don't care about beauty, they just want usability. Well, he performed this experiment once again in his own country. Ironically, the result shown better for the attractive one than in Japan. So what I'm trying to tell you, the truth is, attractive things work better. Well, as designer, if we have balance of attractiveness and usability, we can attain the maximum effectiveness in our design. And how do we do that? We make use of emotions. Well, emotion plays a critical role in our daily life. It helps us assess situations such as dangerous or safe, like his example, the broken car, nobody wants to use it, I will die if I use it, and eventually help us to make decisions. How do we do that? Well, Don Norman has an emotion design model. It helps us interpret how our mind processes the sensory input. In this case, it's basically our five senses. What are we seeing? What information do we get? And it translates into the motto, which is the action, the intuitive reaction. And do take note of the down arrow. They are basically the arrow of control, meaning that reflective level can control behavioral and so on. Okay, so let's go on in depth to each of the level. I'm going to use an example. I'm going to use toilet paper example. Well, why toilet paper? Ihan has used a car, which is very easy to show as an example for the emotion level, the emotion design. But I want to show you that even the simplest thing we use in our daily life can be applied with EDM. Now, the first level is visceral. Well, it's subconscious, and it's basically the look and feel. Look at this toilet roll. I don't think anyone wants to use it. It can wipe your butt clean, but I think it will bleed a bit. It's basically the first impression. And you realize that my first intuitive reaction is, oh no, no, I will bleed if I use it. Because this is a negative example, we know that bad visceral design turns people away. So naturally, good visceral design encourages further interaction. Well, next level is the behavioral, which is like the first level, it's subconscious too. How can we improve the usability of the current toilet roll? The thing is that we are having trouble doing that, so because toilet roll is actually something that through evolve is we repeatedly using toilet roll over and over again, that we're so used to pulling toilet paper out of the toilet roll that if anyone tries to change the design, like pushing the toilet paper to take it out, anyone who's using it will be confused for a second. And there's a sense of control is also important. Now, the current toilet roll, we can roll as much as you want. But what if one day toilet roll is just per button press and it comes out a fixed amount? Wouldn't it be less user-friendly? I mean, everyone's bedside have different size. You want to control your size of the paper as well. And it's also Ihan's, referring back to Ihan's example. Why do people choose between auto car and manual car? Sometimes too much control can be very bad. Can be too much for someone. For me, I like manual car because I can get control. And you already have guessed by now, in fact, behavior level of processing is actually usability. So a good behavior design is actually giving the right level of control, not giving as much control as possible. The last but not least level is actually the reflective level. It's our only conscious thinking mind. Whatever you're thinking now is in fact reflective level. So it's basically our personal preferences and opinions. They carries on, they is derived from our past experiences, which can include our education, upbringing, cultural factor, and so on. Well, it sometimes can be fun and entertainment, entertaining factor. As you can see from this example, money toilet roll. I'm quite poor, you know. Sometimes I want to feel like I'm a rich kid or something. I will probably buy this because it's fun to rub money with against my side. So being the highest level, as you can see from the diagram just now, reflective level is capable of influencing the lower level of processing. Now, as a designer, we must know that good design doesn't mean that we all levels of processing have to have the similar level. Different individuals may respond differently. I mean, depending on the purpose of the design, the three levels of processing may differ. If you can see, this is actually a Japanese novel, toilet roll. And those who understand Japanese and like reading novel and spends a lot of time inside the toilet, don't know doing what, would find this highly behavioral. It's very usable for them. So what about those people who don't understand? This just simply becomes a reflective item. It's just cool. And therefore, a good design utilizes all three levels of processing. When you are employing emotion design model, you should never neglect any one of them. Next, I'm going to pass the baton to Kui Pei, who's going to tell you all how we can apply it on in HCI.
Okay, thank you, Hong Kong. So as what he has mentioned earlier, even though in the ATM example, for two products with the same functionalities, the attractive one would seem to be more effective. And user will have more tolerance for products that is attractive when as compared to a badly designed one. So in this example, the website, it's actually, the design is very plain, but it's well functioned. And hence, users won't feel, they won't feel confused or frustrated when they are using this website to purchase a product. In this website, the funky design goes well with their product. And this website is actually very informative. It helps to reassure users when they want to buy a product. So, however, in this website, it's looks unreliable, there's many tags, and it's hard for user to understand. Yeah, and I guess a user would feel frustrated easily when they try to navigate within this website. Well, not all products have to look attractive, but have to look pleasant looking. If you want to induce certain emotions such as fear in your user. Well, to apply EDM to HCI design, it does not mean that you design a product that adapts to emotion, because this is unrealistic and people's emotion changes all the time. So Norman's suggested approach is to focus on the context and the purpose your product is being used for. So for example, how long would a user use your product? Like laptops and mobile phones. So what kind of material will you use for it? And also, in what situation do user use your product? Like in serious situations such as this medical device, do you include a game in it? I'm sure you won't do it, right? So yeah, here are some examples of how you can apply certain elements to design for the three levels of emotions. For the visceral level, you can make use of classical music and matching colors to give the pleasant feel. And on the behavioral level, in situations such as warnings and alerts, you can make use of alarms and the color red to give a sense of urgency in your user. So in different cultures, there are different types of musical style and different colors that represent them. So you can use this to give the emotions in the reflective level. Now, for more example, we'll be using text and images. You can use these two together to create humor, give instruction, and even intrigue user to certain situations. So this is actually straightforward because text and image itself is descriptive. You can use video the same way because it's a combination of image and text. So the main point is that you have to be clear of what is the purpose of your product. Then you can alter each element to accommodate each level of emotions. Yeah, so there's actually another model which works well with EDM. It's the pleasure model, which I will not go into details because the next group will be doing it. So a general idea of this that is that it helps designers to explore ways to induce various pleasure in four areas when using a product. So the four areas is namely physical, social, psychological, and ideological. So when you put these two models together, it complements each other. As pleasure model enhances user experience with regards to your four areas, EDM actually helps you to understand the structure of the three levels of emotions. This will help you predict users' emotion when they are using your product, and it also allows you to be clear of the consideration you have when designing for the three models. The three levels, sorry. Yeah, so in conclusion, emotional design model helps designers to understand people's emotion in different contexts, and it helps designers to design for or try to reduce certain emotions. And do remember that products that induces positive emotions are better than competitors. In a sense, given that the two products have the same functionalities and usability. So attractive thing works better. So thank you.
Any questions?